All right, let's all get our hymnals this evening. Stand and sing page number 131. Number 131. I was once a sinner, but I came pardon to receive from my Lord. This was freely given, and I found that He's always kept His word. There's a new name written out in glory, and it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. Story, a sinner has come home, for there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven evermore to roam. I was humbly kneeling at the cross, fearing not by God's angry frown. When the heavens opened and I saw that my name was written down, and there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story. A sinner has come home, for there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven. In the book 'tis written, saved by grace, all the joy that came to my soul. Now I am forgiven, and I know by the blood I am made whole. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story. A sinner has come home, for there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven evermore to
I'm working on a road that leads to glory. I want to shake my Savior's hand.
I'm building my home on things eternal,
on things of glory. I'm working on a road.
I'm working on a road to glory land.
Each day I get so lonely while living here below. My Savior's waiting patiently, I'm planning now to go. I want a firm foundation built by God's own hand. That's why I started building this road to glory land. And I'm working on a road that leads to glory. I want to shake my Savior's hand.
I'm building my home on things eternal.
On things eternal, I'm working on a road.
I'm working on a road to glory land.
Oh, listen to me, sinner, don't you want to go? You know we have no promise of living here below. You know he suffered for our sins and died upon the cross. For all who would believe in him, their souls would not be lost. And I'm working on a road that leads to glory. I want to shake my Savior's hand. I'm building my home
on things eternal.
On things eternal, I'm working on a road.
I'm working on a road to glory land.
And when this road is finished, I want to travel on. I can hear the angels singing up there around the throne. I want to see my mother, take her by the hand. As soon as I have finished this road to glory land. And I'm working on a road that leads to glory. I want to shake my Savior's hand.
I'm building my home
on things eternal. On things eternal, I'm working on a road.
I'm working on a road to glory land.
I'm working on a road that leads to glory. I want to shake my Savior's hand.
I'm building my home.
I'm building my home
on things eternal.
On things eternal, I'm working on the road.
I'm working on a road to glory.
To glory.
Free.
two fish and a little bread. I believe one day he's coming back. That's what the Bible says. I believe he fed the thousands with two fish and a little bread. I believe one day he's coming back.
That's what the Bible says.
Amen, amen. Get your Bibles and go with me to the book of Luke this evening. The book of Luke. Luke chapter number 24. Luke chapter 24 this evening. Thank the Lord for the good day. Good service this morning. God's blessing us up real good, and I thank him for that. That's a whole lot better than an old dead service, ain't it? Amen? Amen. I've had my experiences with dead services. I'm done with those. I want God to have his will and his way in each service. So Luke chapter number 24, Luke 24, verse number 13. You're familiar with this if you read your Bible very much, about the disciples that were on the road to Emmaus. We're going to deal with that just a little bit this evening and try to share a thought with you. If you would, stand reverence to God's word. If you're able, if you're not, then you're fine to keep your seat. Luke chapter 24, verse 13. And behold, two of them that went that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 60 furlongs. And they talked together of all these things which had happened. And it came to pass that while they communed together and reasoned, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were holding that they should not know him. And he said unto them, what manner of communications are these that ye have one with another as you walk and are sad? And one of them, whose name was Cleophas, answered, said unto him, art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem, and hast not known these things which are come to pass in these days? And he said unto them, what things? And they answered unto him, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and have crucified him. But we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel. Besides all this, today is the third day since these things were done. Yea, and certain women also of our company made us astonished, which were early at the sepulcher, and they found not his body. They came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels, which said that that he was alive. And certain of them which were with us went to the sepulchre and found it even so as the women had said, but him they saw not. Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart, believe all that the prophets have spoken? Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scripture these things concerning himself. And they drew nigh unto the village whither they went, and he made as though he would have gone further. But they constrained him, saying, abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in and tarried with them. And it came to pass, as he sat at meat with them, he took bread and blessed it and brake it and gave to them, and their eyes were open, and they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight. And they said one to another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the way, and while he opened unto us the scriptures, they arose up the same hour, nighttime now, they rose up the same hour and returned to Jerusalem and found the 11 gathered together and them that were with them, saying, the Lord is risen indeed and hath appeared unto Simon. And they told what things were done in the way and how he was known of them in breaking of bread. Our Father, in the name of Jesus, I come before you. Thank you for the good word of God that you've given us and preserved for us. I thank you, Lord, for the men, the women that bled and died that we might have this liberty tonight. Father, we pray that you'll take thy word, use it in our hearts, do that work that we need. As you did with these disciples, we pray that you'll touch our hearts and help us. Meet the needs. Be with those that are sick, those that are afflicted, those that cannot be with us tonight. I pray you'd touch them, touch their bodies, give them help and healing. We pray, Lord, especially for Preacher Joe, that you'd touch him. The days ahead, Lord, you know what is there, and I pray that God should help him, give him comfort and grace, bless his family, and Lord, have your perfect will. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Thank you for standing. Now, as we look at this passage of Scripture, we're aware of what has taken place. In the first part of chapter 24, they went to the ladies had went to the sepulcher, and they saw that it was that the Lord was gone, and there was a little conversation there with Mary Magdalene and the mother of Jesus, and all that they had learned, and these disciples had been with them and heard these things. But after hearing a little bit of it, they decided to leave out and head towards Emmaus. Some have speculated that maybe Emmaus is where they lived and they was headed back home. Some have said that maybe they were going back to where they used to work or going back to their old ways because they're so discouraged and disheartened. They're on a path that is a path of discouragement, not a path leading to discouragement, but they're on a path of discouragement because Jesus said to them, are you sad? Can you imagine what their face would look like when the Lord walks up and begins to talk with them, and they're like, you just don't know how bad it's been these days, you know. And you listen to them talk about what has went on, and you realize their discouragement, but then you realize that they're defeated. They make a statement there. They make a statement there in verse number 21. They say, but we trusted. They're saying they'd put all their confidence in the Lord, and that's something I'll deal with a little bit more in a minute, but here's a group of guys that's walking the road and they're so beat down, they're so discouraged. And instead of staying with the disciples and letting the disciples and all of them minister one to another, they said, we're going on back to Emmaus, and down the road they go. Now, y'all know the story that goes on there with the disciples. Had they hung around, they'd have got to see Jesus. Sometimes folks leave out just a little bit too early, and they miss what God's got for them. Sometimes folks will make a departure just a little bit too early and they miss all the blessings that the Lord would have for them because they just get too impatient, they get too down and out, they get too defeated, and they just go on about their business. So here are these disciples. They're on the path of discouragement. They're in a place of defeat. They're on this Emmaus Road. And according to different studies there, it's about a 7-mile journey is what is supposed. So a furlong is 528 feet, what your Scofield Bible tells you there in the middle, and it was 7 miles or so of that. Some says it was a little further than that. I don't know for sure. I haven't been there. I don't know. I think Miss Kay's been over there. Did y'all walk the Emmaus Road? Did y'all see the Emmaus Road? Sometimes on those tours, they'll take you down and show you that road that leads up to Emmaus. It's a different city name now, but the place is still there, of course. But they're headed up that road to Emmaus. Maybe that's where they lived. Maybe they're doing like Simon Peter. Maybe they're saying, I'm done, I quit. What's the use? What I hope for, what I look for, what I trusted in is gone. You know, sometimes maybe y'all sing the song, we've even held those dreams in our hands. And they go, the anchor holds. You know, sometimes things that we thought was to be one way ends up not working out just like that. See, some things are not going to work out just the way we got it pre-planned. Because if you realize it, it's not about what our plans is, it's about what His plans is. And we do much better when we stay with His plans rather than trying to do ours. Now, they're for sure headed away from Jerusalem. Get a hold of that picture now. Their spiritual parts you're looking at, they're leaving Jerusalem. They're leaving the holy city. They're leaving the place of worship and headed away from it. And that's a danger. You got to be careful. Now, I'm going to deal with that thought just a minute tonight. On where are you headed? What where are you headed for? What course have you decided to take? See, each of us has that free will. We have a decision that we can make on what our course is going to be. Are we on a course that leads us to a closer walk with the Lord? Are we on a course that leads us to the closer place with the Lord at the house of God? Or are we on a course that's leading us away from it? A great fear sometimes in watching how folks make decisions and their decisions, you can see their decision is going to take them away from doing the work of the Lord. And here's an answer a lot of them will throw you. Well, I'm going to do it this way. I think I can be a more help to the Lord in this. But they're going to be away from church more time. They're going to be away from abilities to give and do more for the church. And I'm not talking about money. I'm talking about giving themself and being involved with things. And when you see that direction coming, you know that there's not good on the end of that road. I ask you again, what course have you decided? Now, see, these guys here have headed out away from Jerusalem. They're appearing to walk away. They're not staying loyal to the cause. There was a cause here. This cause is Calvary. They ought to be staying loyal to Calvary, but what scriptures they've read and what has been prefixed in their mind versus what the scripture says. See, Jesus asked him a question. He makes a statement and a question to him there about what Jesus would come for. Verse 26 says, ought not Christ to have suffered these things? He'd been preaching that to him, hadn't he? Hadn't he been preaching to him and telling them that, you know, the Son of Man must needs suffer, the Son of Man must be crucified, the Son of Man must be taken. He, over and over, he went through what God was going to let happen and what was going to take place. And they wasn't listening. They wasn't getting it. See, sometimes we can have a preset ideal in our mind, and regardless of what somebody says to us, we ain't hearing it. We're not getting a hold of what they're saying because we already got our minds made up. You need to learn not to be that way. God help us. Amen. Not to be prefixed and preset with our own ideals that God, when He speaks to us, we can't hear Him speaking because we done figured out what He's supposed to be doing. He's come to redeem Israel. Well, my goodness, ain't that what He done? I mean, He did redeem Israel, but they're really not talking about just redeeming Israel. They're talking about Him setting up kingdom. You go back and listen to the disciples talk about these things, and what they was really looking for Him to do was take His place on the throne of David. They was looking for Him to sit down on that throne and be King of Kings and Lord of Lords right then and there for them. They was looking for freedom away from the Roman government controls. So what they was looking for was not happening their way in their preset mind. It caused them some problems. They wasn't being loyal to the cause. You know, y'all to be loyal. Y'all hearing me tonight? Y'all to be loyal to the cause because of His salvation. We ought to be loyal to the cause because of the supplies that He's given us. We ought to be loyal because of the sicknesses that He's brought us through and the sight that He's given us and the strength that He's given us and the saints that He's put us around and the sanctuary He's given us to come to. We ought to stay loyal to the cause. But we get flustered because things don't seemingly go the way that we thought it should have went. You know, I'll be honest, if I'd have been in their day, I'd have been like, Lord, why didn't You whoop that bunch of soldiers when they showed up? I'd have been Simon Peter. I'd have drawn a sword and went to cutting ears too. I know who Curtis is. That's what I'd done. I'd have been, you ain't taking my Lord. Oh, no. But it had to be that way. That was part of God's ordained plan. You got to remember that when they come to get Jesus in the garden, he'd already told them at the supper table, one of you is going to betray me. It's going to happen. It went just exactly the way God planned it, just exactly the way the Lord told it. But it wasn't according to the way they had it figured out. And that's sometimes when we get in trouble, we try to look at things in our way. You got to realize here, they're headed out of town. They're leaving their other comrades. They're not only are they not being loyal to the cause, they're leaving their other comrades. These other disciples are sitting there, and they're not there to help them. Can I say something to you without you getting mad at me? It ain't all about you. Maybe you could be the one to bring encouragement to the others. Maybe you could be the one to say, hey, wait a minute, you know, it's still worth it. Even though it feels like sometimes we suffer a defeat, we suffer a setback, it's still worth it. God help us not to leave the comrades. God help us not to be disloyal to the cause. God help us to stay loyal to the things that God's given us. You know, the Bible does still say not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another. We're supposed to be building each other up. Did you hear what she said? Not that kind of business. We ought to be encouraging one another, building each other up, trying to be the best we can be for the glory of God. Amen. And we're supposed to do that so much the more as you see the day approaching. What they have done is they've made a decision on their own based on their own needs. See, when we become part of the work of God, it's not just about my needs. It's about our needs collectively. You know, when you go back and look at the early church in the book of Acts, there was folks there that contributed to the church because other folks in the church had need. And those that had the ability to do so sold homes and gave their part to the church so other folks that was part of the church could have their needs met. You know, y'all don't get upset with me, but if the church was doing what it needed to be, there'd be a lot less need for government aid. You know, it is still God's order for the church to take care of its widows. Amen. It is still God's order. We're trying to here. I'm trying to. We're trying to do what we're supposed to do in those areas. We're trying to be a help in that. God help us. Amen. So we have these folks here, and they've decided a course. What course have you decided? What road are you on today? You on a road that's leading you closer to Jerusalem, closer to the holy city, closer to your walk with the Lord? Or are you on the road to Emmaus, headed away from the things of God, headed away from what God wants you to do? Now, when you think about these guys, you got to look back at their discouragement and what caused their discouragement. I'll be fair with you. They really had a good cause for losing discouragement. Or for gaining discouragement. They had a good cause because they had lost their God. They literally had watched the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, their God. They've literally watched Him hang on a cross and die. The one that meant so much to them, the one that was their leader, the one that was their guide, the one that was their comfort, the one that was there to meet all their needs is gone. So they've lost their God, and in that they've lost their goals. What they thought, what they was looking for, what they was hoping for, what they was trusting in appears now to be gone. Now we know the story. We got the Bible. We can sit down and read it. We can sit back and look at those guys on the road to Emmaus and say, what a foolish thing for y'all to do. But how many times have we, because we don't have a script written, because we have made decisions or went in directions or made choices in life that was contrary to drawing us closer and letting us be more of an aid or a help or an encouragement to the brethren, we've sort of done our own thing. Amen. Don't get quiet now. See, what caused their discouragement was the loss of Christ. They said, we trusted. Was your trust in Him to do something that was your way? Because we know the fact is He done exactly the perfect will of Almighty God. He fulfilled the Father's will. It was contrary to what they thought. So because you trusted in Him and it didn't work out exactly the way you said, then you're going to throw all your trust and confidence in Him away? It still worked out right, but not my right. It was His right. It was not my way, it was His way. And see, that's a lot of times where we get in trouble with the Lord is we've got our preset ideas, we've got our preset desires, we've got our preset wants and wishes, and God will come along and say, hey, wait a minute. This is a little different than what I've got. This is the way I've got it planned out. And we need to follow His plan, His will, because His way, His will is right. Now, the Lord has made a special trip out here to catch up with these guys on the road to Emmaus. And He takes time out and He has a little conversation with them. They have lost in their mind. They think they've lost Christ. They haven't, but they think that way. They feel that way. They're discouraged. They're sad. They feel like they've lost. You know, a lot of folks feel like they've lost out. Something that they had as a goal, something they had as a guard, something they had as a guide, someone that was very close to them, that was a guarantee for life. They've lost. They feel like we've lost it all, but you need to remember, you're saved, a child of God. You've got Jesus, amen? They had a lack of confidence, verse 22 and 23 there. They just didn't, I mean, they heard a little story, but they didn't even believe that story. You read that in 22 and 23 where they had heard about the women, and the women told them this, and they had seen a vision of angels, and so on and so forth, and that He was alive, but, you know, they ain't believing nothing. You know, it's sometimes that you just ain't going to help some folk. It's going to take an act of Jesus to make a difference. You know, that's really what we want, though, right? We want to be what we can and should be as a church, to where the Spirit of God's got liberty in here where He can actually do the work, not us. I prefer it that way because He does it right. I might get my words twisted up. I might not say it just right. I may be more of an offense than a help to them. And I don't want that, but, you know, letting the Lord do it. There's a lack of confidence. Galatians 5:10 says, I have confidence in you through the Lord that ye will be none otherwise minded, but he that troubleth you shall bear his judgment whosoever he be. And you got to remember that there's folks that's going to cause you trouble. Let them alone. Like I preached this morning, don't get sidetracked to what the main goal is. Don't lose sight of the real battle. If you need to, you can come back and take care of that. But just sort of let that go. The Lord take care of that. God knows how to bring judgment. And I'm testifying tonight. I know that God knows how to take care of those that's an offense. I know God knows how to take care of those that offend you and those that hurt you and those that get in the way. God can and will take care of that crowd. I've listened to preacher stories through the years, and I can stand here and tell you many stories where somebody was in opposition to the work of God and God physically took them out. I've got a Bible story that I can take you over there to where Korah stood against Moses, he and 250. You know what God did? He opened up the heart of the earth and swallowed 250 men alive into the heart of the earth and closed her back up. What they did, they went straight to hell. They didn't die. They went straight to hell. God's got a way of taking care of those that are offense, those that are offensive to His work. He'll take care of them. Just let God do. 2 Corinthians 8:22 says, and we have sent with them our brother, whom we have oftentimes proved diligent in many things, but how much more diligent upon the great confidence which I have in you. Can the Lord put confidence? Can other laborers of the Lord put confidence in you? We need to be living a Christian life that where others can know and trust that we're going to do what we said we're going to do. We're going to be where we said we're going to be. We're going to help when we say we're going to help. We need to be somebody that others can have confidence in, trust in, to know that, hey, when I get in need, they're going to be there. You know, that's a very important thing to the Christian walk. You don't know what the world's going to do. I'll tell you this. I know how the world treats you as a young feller. And all the buddy system things you got going on, that buddy system works pretty good as long as you can do for them. But that buddy system don't work too good when you're the one that's in need. Contrary to the church, though, church, God's going to help you. God's going to take care of you. Somehow or another, God's going to meet your needs. One may not, but another will. I learned in traveling when we was on the road, living by faith every minute of every day, I learned that where I expected the help to come from, it didn't come. Our help often come from those that were of lesser ability to help, but they done it. I was with the church preaching and working, and the church had the ability to help and meet a need that we had while we was traveling. They didn't do it. Got a phone call from a fellow. He said, "Hey, I'd like to take you and your wife out to eat if you can go." You know, I said, "Sure, we'll set up." So we went and eat. We thought we was just going to eat and fellowship with him. And he said, "The Lord's been working in my heart about this matter." He said, "I've saw that you have a need." And while we were sitting there at the table, he reached a check across the table for $1,000. The church that I was at, that he was there in that meeting, could have very easily taken care of the need that we had, but they failed to do so. And God worked it out to where some other individual saw that need and wanted to be a blessing and wrote me $1,000 check sitting right there eating. I about lost my supper. $1,000. Y'all know what $1,000 is? Now, honey, that's been, I'll be 14 years here in August. That's been well yonder past 14 years ago. Probably about 16, 18 years ago. So down there and wrote me a check for $1,000 and said, "Here, put that on your need." I hadn't asked for nothing. I hadn't said nothing about that need. But see, God's got a way. God, you can put confidence that God's going to meet your needs. God's going to take care of you. God knows your need before you ever asked. Ain't that what he said? But he wants you to ask. That's part of the program he set up. I don't understand all that, but that's what he wants you to do. Hey, maybe it's about he wants us to humble ourselves because he can work with us better humble than he can with us full of pride and knowing we can do it all. Talked about that a little bit this morning, didn't we? When you look at these guys, you can't get over anywhere. It's raining and they're beating the bands out there. When you look at these guys here, you see these two walking on the road to Emmaus. And you notice there's a directional change in their plans. Verse 33, it shows that they immediately. Now, you got to back up because I made a statement a while ago and some of you sort of looked at me a little bit. And they was talking to him about it being the evening time and they asked him just to hang out with them since it was getting toward the evening. Y'all remember that? And they drew nigh the village whither they would and he made as if he'd go further, but they constrained him to come in and abide with them because it was toward evening. That's in verse number 29. They sat down and they eat. Let's do an average. Let's say they sit there an hour. He sits there, communes with them for an hour. They eat their meal, and he's gone. He vanished out of their sight. They didn't say, "Okay, boy, that's a good little talk with the Lord. I think I'll go lay down." No, they didn't. They got up and they went back to town. What the Bible says there, verse 33 says, "And they rose up the same hour and returned to Jerusalem." Now, I want to remind you folks of something. They didn't go out there getting their pickup truck, crank it up, and ride back up to Jerusalem. They didn't go over there to the counter and reach and grab their flashlight so they could see where they was walking going back up the way. Y'all getting that? They were so excited and stirred up that they hit the trail at night without all those special effects that we've got, and they went back to town. They had been stirred so in their heart, they said, "Did not our heart burn within us?" They'd been stirred so in their heart that they wanted to get back to Jerusalem, and they wasn't waiting till morning. It don't show that they took time. Let me go ahead and take my shower and change clothes, and we'll be ready to go. They didn't do all that extra fixing up. They just said, we're going back to town right now. And back to town they went that same hour. You see, they had a change of direction. Reason they had a change of direction, because they had a learning through the Scriptures. The Lord Jesus didn't just throw out something at them. He took them to the Scripture, and the Bible says that he preached, beginning at Moses and all the prophets, and he preached himself to these guys. So, shows me one of the big turning points in changing your direction is to get in your Bible. Get in those Scriptures and let the Lord speak to you through the Scriptures. And let the Lord reveal some things to you through the Scriptures. That'll change that discouraged direction. You'll be headed back to God's house. Amen? Amen. So they had a learning of the Scripture. But then they had another thing that really got them. Says, and their eyes was open in verse 31. And they got to see Him. They got a look of the Savior. They learned it in the Scriptures. And then He breaks the bread. And when He broke it, you know the Lord probably prayed about the same when He eat. Sort of like we do. Lord, thank You for this food. Pray You'll bless it to nourish our bodies to Thy service. That's pretty much my prayer when I eat. And I'd say that when He picked up that bread and blessed it, it's the same way that He'd bless them loaves and fishes that day on the mountainside when they had that little lad's lunch. And any other time that they eat, He blessed and break the bread and blessed it. He was thankful, gave thanks unto the Father for the food. Amen. Y'all say, thank You, Lord, for Your food. Amen. Amen. You getting to eat, y'all say, thank You, Lord. Amen. I think folks that gets unthankful ought to have to go to one of the foreign lands to where they ain't got much to eat but roaches and caterpillars and worms and things of that nature. You'd be glad for an old roll. Amen. We've got some spoilt over here. I'm telling you, we rotten, ain't we? We get about whatever we want to eat. I mean, it's pretty easy to get about what you want to eat these days, you know. These folks in other lands that don't do what we do in America. And these people want a bad mouth, run their mouth against America. I wish they'd pack up and go over yonder. Amen. I'm with that senator down in Florida. Hey, get your stuff together. We'll buy you a ticket. We'll send you over to sea. You don't like America? Get out. We'll help you get there. Where are you going to go? What country? And they'll shut up real quick over that. Because all they want to do is run their mouth and get somebody to look at them. All they want is attention. And if they're that unthankful for the country God gave us America. Amen? God gave us America. God helped us to win the land and to be able to be free. Amen? And to worship Him. That was what it's all about. So let's not mess up what He gave us. Let's make sure we worship Him. Amen. When you look at these guys, they had a change of direction because of the learning in the Scriptures and the look of the Savior. And that's what makes a difference with us. Dear preacher years ago preached this same passage of Scripture. And I got his outline there. And he talked about the discouraged saints that you start out with. And then he talked about the disguised Savior. And then he talked about the disciples were sad and they were defeated. And then there's a declared sermon the Lord gave. And then he shows there's a desire change in the soul. And then there's a divine supply given. And then there's those that were delivered by His strength. So see, God's got a way of taking things that's bad and turning it around when we'll stop and pay attention to it. Pretty good little trip they took up the Emmaus Road. Obviously, they made it to the house. If it's a 7-mile journey, that'd take you a few minutes to get there if you walk pretty fast. You know, somewhere around 45 minutes to an hour on a normal walk. If you get you a good little pace, you can do it in about 25, 30 minutes. But that's a mile, so you got to multiply that by 7. Can y'all do that? If it's 7 half-hours, you'd end up with 3.5 full hours, maybe. Y'all okay? Y'all do math? So we're looking at the best they're gonna do, Brother Virgil, is probably about a 3.5 hour walk. And Jesus preaching to them, talking to them the whole time. And sometimes we get bogged down on a 30-minute sermon. You shouldn't have said amen right there. But that's the truth. But see, when you're in a pretty bad situation like these guys were, super discouraged, super defeated, headed for another way, it takes him a little bit longer sometimes to get that message across to us and to deal with us. And these guys here, you know, they had a good little walk with the Lord. And it brings us back to the thought of, where are you headed? If you continue on the trail that you're on tonight, if you continue in the direction that your life is going, where are you headed? Are you, as a child of God, one of His disciples, headed away from Him? Or are you pointed in a direction that's going to lead you closer to Him? Are you spending time in the Scriptures? Are you spending time with the Savior to where it's going to make you want to be closer to Him? Maybe even get up in the middle of the night and head towards His house? Maybe get up in the middle of the night and head to your Bible to get a little closer something from the Lord. You know the sad thing, church? God help us. God forgive us. Really, God forgive us. Sometimes we don't crack our Bibles open till we really got a need. And we'll get so down, out, discouraged, and defeated, and fearful, and all kinds of problems going through our minds, and we'll get up in the middle of the night and go over and pick up our Bibles and read it and look for God to give us an answer and give us help and give us something. You know, we ought to want to feed a little more than that on the things of God. We'd probably have less times of discouragement if we spent more times dining with Him. So we need to be more about spending some time in His book than just using the book as the crutch, than just using the book as a spare tire. God help us to spend some more time reading in it and letting Him speak to our hearts and learning more of Him, and it'll help us. You know, some guys, like these guys here, I sort of look at these guys as they just sort of enjoyed the trip hanging around with the Lord. Somewhere, probably in the neighborhood of 3 years, they've been hanging around the Lord, and they didn't get that message He kept preaching about, I must be crucified, but I'm going to rise again on the third day. You know, some folks will sit around and be around for a long time before it finally sets in on them. I don't know the reason behind all that, but I know that happens. But the good ending to this story is they was delivered. The good ending to this story is they got the help they needed and they headed back to where they should be with the Lord. Let's close tonight. Where are you headed? What direction is your focus and what direction are you walking? Are you walking closer to God? Or are you trying to hang out with the other crowd? Are you walking closer to God? Are you trying to fellowship more with the Lord? Are you trying to get as close as you can and trying to know the will of God for your life, what God wants, or you're just sort of headed the other way because things ain't really went the way you thought it should go? You know, I could go through a whole menu of stuff tonight that didn't go the way I thought it ought to went. You wouldn't have nowhere to said things that went the way I thought it should have went. You would not have anywhere to sit in here. This place would be packed slap out if things went exactly the way I thought it ought to go. It'd be a lot of folks God had saved, but God offers, they just won't receive. That's up to them. These disciples that went to Emmaus, they made that choice. They made that decision. They chose that direction. What direction are you choosing tonight? Are you drawing closer, or are you content where you are? Let's pray. Father, have your will tonight. Take these simple thoughts that we've given. Use them for your honor and for your glory. And Lord, I pray that you'd help us. I know there's folks here tonight that's discouraged. Not going to say they're defeated. I don't think they've quite got there, but Lord, they sure some folks discouraged. And I pray that through the message tonight, through your word, that you'll work in their heart. I pray, Lord Jesus, that you'd burn it in them like you did these. They said, did not our hearts burn within us? I pray that you'll burn a message in their heart. Let them see that you died, you rose again, and you're coming again. And you have the supplies and all the needs that we have can be met in you. And I pray that God, you'll work those things out for us. Help whoever needs it tonight. I ask you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand. You mind the Lord. God's talked to you a little bit tonight, then you mind the Lord. You follow what the Lord's doing in your heart. You're not really where you need to be, get there.